Okay guys, hi, my name is Marco, and we're going to start Fernando's third and final lecture, so go on.
Thank you. Hello everyone, I hope you are refreshed after the boat trip yesterday. So this will be the last lecture, unfortunately, and if you remember the first lecture, I promise you we see a lot of different things. We reverse you on the topic of the first lecture. So you won't see everything, so what I want to do today is to finish this what I start telling you about thermodynamics, like kind of resource theory, and then I will use slides and just like mention a little bit of the other topics. I won't get into a lot of details, but only for you to get a flavor of what they are, and maybe you can read more about them if you like. So, okay, so just let us just remind what we did last time. So first we start with this theory of purity, right, which was like this one part of this theory of thermodynamics that we saw later, but where we don't have energy conservation, we only have like entropy conservation of purity, right? And then one important concept was relative entropy. That's the definition of the relative entropy. So it's always positive, it can diverge, so it has no upper bounds. And if you want to think in terms of information theory, there is this interpretation as a rate of hypothesis testing, right? So if you have two states, rho and tau, and you want many copies of one or many copies of the other, if you want to distinguish which one we have, when n grows, we can distinguish better and better, we can distinguish with exponentially small properties of error, and the relative entropy is exactly this exponent in the decaying properties of error. So this gives some interpretation for it. And then, of course, in thermodynamics, there are others that we saw later in the lecture. And then we just, in this theory of purity, what mattered was the relative entropy of a state rho to the maximum mixed states that we call tau. And then if you just do the calculation, this is basically just the entropy. Or neg entropy is log dimension of the state minus the entropy. Then we saw that, right, by some simple arguments, that this S rho of tau, the relative entropy of a state to the maximum mixed state, is a monotone with respect to this class of operations which were noisy operations. And being a monotone is useful because it gives you bounds on the rate of conversion of one state into the other. So this monotonicity is basically just a property of this very important property of relative entropy, which we call data processing inequality. Just says that if you apply a quantum operation to a state, this integrability only gets worse, so the relative entropy only gets smaller. And then we saw one result, which was like an asymptotic result, that we can go from many copies of rho to many copies of sigma, if and only if the relative entropy to the maximum mixed state of rho is bigger than the one of sigma. So this relative entropy is the only thing that matters if you have many copies and if you have noisy operations. Then we saw that this was just like using basic compression, right? So it was just application of compression of quantum information. Then we look at single-shot transformations, and there the criterion was in terms of majorization, right? We can go from rho into sigma by a noisy operation if and only if rho majorizes sigma. So if only if like the level of mixedness of sigma is bigger than of rho. Again, the proof was simple. We just, right, we use this characterization of majorization in terms of convex combination of applied permutations to the property distribution. And then finally, from noise operation, we look at catalytic transformations, right? And then just using these results that we saw before, that this trumping relation for probability distribution is given by Rennie entropies, we got this criteria, right? That's rho can be mapped to sigma by noisy operations with a catalyst, if and only if, again, something very similar to the asymptotic case, but now with more entropies, if all Rennie entropies, they are monotonic, if all Rennie entropies increase, right? And then this you can think as some very weak version of the second law of thermodynamics, right, which says that processes that are possible, they have to increase the entropy, or at least preserve the entropy. This is what you see, right? The entropy goes up when we have like this physical possible process in these noisy operations. Then we got to the more interesting case, which is trying to do something similar for thermodynamics, or actually just like part of thermodynamics, and which is in the sense of a resource theory of entropy and energy at the same time. So the idea is that we have a system with some Hamiltonian HS, we have a bath at some temperature T, and we're interested in isothermal processes, so the system can interact with the bath, they can exchange particles, and they can exchange energy, but the temperature is fixed, you cannot change the temperature. And then we understand thermodynamics in this setting well, right? We know that manifestation of the second law of thermodynamics in this case is in terms of the monotonicity of the free energy, meaning that the free energy, which is given by mean energy minus temperature, minus temperature and entropy, that this is always monotonic decreasing, right? So whenever we have an isothermal operation, free energy has to go down. And then now we wanna see whether we can formulate something similar on the quantum level when we only have a few particles, for example, and which is more in the sense of these other resource theories where we can pose fundamental operations like unitaries and so on. And this was the motivation for these thermal operations, right? And they consisted of three basic operations. One was like this interaction with the heat bath, and this we modeled as the ability to add any Gibbs states to our system, right? So we can add any quantum state as long as it has this form, right? Which is, you know, you can write this as e to the minus h for some Hermitian operator h. Then we also, another thing that we could do is unitaries as noisy operations, but now, different from noisy operations, we cannot implement any unitary, only unitary that preserve the energy. So we have a total Hamiltonian of the system and the reservoir of the bath, and we can apply any unitary we want, but they have to commute to this Hamiltonian. And we can trace out. So one way to look at this theory of purity would be just to say that this is a particular case of these thermal operations, but where the both Hamiltonians of the system and the bath, they are identity, right? And which means you can do any unitary you want. Then one question that we ask is whether we can recover standard thermodynamics results in this paradigm, right? For example, can we recover that free energy is the relevant quantity? And then we wonder whether this might be the case, because this seems very different from thermodynamics, in which we assume full control of the energy levels, right? We can implement any unitary as long as it preserves energy, whereas in thermodynamics usually we have like this coarse control over the system. Here we can also use arbitrary heat baths. Maybe if you use some very engineered heat bath, you can get something better, and so on. And then the claim, right, that we did, that we start proving, but we didn't finish, and we will finish now, is that free energy is still the relevant thing, at least for these asymptotic transformations. So we saw one claim that was simple to prove as well, that free energy is monotone under thermal operations. And more specifically, that we can connect the free energy to the relative entropy to the thermal state, right? So we have this identity that I ask you to check as a homework, right? There you have temperature times the relative entropy of rho to the Gibbs state that's equal to a difference of free energies, the free energy of the state rho, to the free energy of the thermal state. So this free energy of the thermal state doesn't matter, this is fixed given the Hamiltonian and the temperature. So really this free energy is nothing that's the relative entropy of rho to the thermal state up to this Adamson effect. And then we saw these results that that we can completely understand when we can go from rho to sigma by thermal operations if we are in this asymptotic regime, so if we have many copies of each one. So we can do the conversion if and only if the relative entropy is monotonic, it decreases, which is, because of this identity we just saw, equivalent to the free energy decreasing. Okay, So this is kind of what we expect from thermodynamics, right? Free energy decides when we can do a transformation, and it's the only thing that matters in this setting. So we saw this means it's a reversible theory, doesn't matter which state you have, you can convert from to another one and back. And then to start proving these results, we define what we mean by work in this paradigm, right? So work usually is to, you know, for example, lifting your weights. So we have energy in this localized degree of freedom. So here is something similar, but it's microscopic, it's quantum. So here, we just imagine that warp is exciting, for example, a two-level atom to a quantum state, which is exactly the excited state, so with zero entropy. And if the energy splitting between the ground state and the excited state is zero, we say this is a bit of work of E0 genres. So given this, right, this bit of work really is just some reference states, some states that we are going to fix. And then to prove this result that free energy is all that matters, we are going to study two processes. One was warp distillation, and the idea here is to try to map the state's row to as many copies as possible to this one state, to this like warp bits. And we want to optimize the rate m that we can do that. Then we can define the reverse process, which is this warp cost. Here we start from some like m bits of warp, and by Fermat operations we want to distill one copy of row, and we want to see the minimum number of copies, or no, the minimum number of bits of warp that we need to do that. And an equivalent way of stating the theorem is just that these two functions, they are the same, and they are equal to this relative entropy of resource, the relative entropy to the Gibbs state. And then we start, we didn't finish, but we start seeing why that's the case, and we focus first on warp distillation, right? So what's the problem, right? So one direction is easy, that we cannot distill more than this quantity. That was easy, that's just monotonicity of this quantity with respect to Fermat operations, right? But now we need the reverse process. Now we need a protocol for extracting work which achieves exactly this rate, right? And this is what we start seeing how to get it. Then we focus on the simplest situation possible, which is already interesting, which is when all the systems, they are qubits, so rho is a qubit. Moreover, we assume that rho is diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. So the Hamiltonian that we consider was a single qubit Hamiltonian with energy E0 in the excited state, and the ground state has energy 0. And then we assume that rho was diagonal in this energy eigenbasis first. The Gibbs state is what it is, right? That's the form of the Gibbs state. And our goal was to use some number of copies of the Gibbs state, like L copies of the Gibbs state. Doesn't matter, L, what it is, can be anything, it's a free resource. Then we start from N copies of rho. And then we want to implement a unitary, which preserves energy, such that in the end we have N copies of this orbit, right? N copies of one. And of course it's unitary, so we have to conserve dimension, so we must have some extra state, sigma k, we call this exhaust state, and it doesn't matter what it is, right? You just throw it away in the end. So there are two numbers that will matter here. One is the rate of the protocol, which is the important one, right? This gives the distillation rate, and this is m over n, right? The number of warp bits per number of states row that we invested. And another number is just, this doesn't matter really, but we have to take it to go to zero for in the end, is the number of resource states per number of Gibbs states that we use, so n over n. And then this is where we stopped. I gave you a very brief description of the protocol last time, or part of it, right? But it was very fast. So I'm going to repeat it now, okay? And hopefully it'll be more clear. So the idea, how to do it. Before I do that, any question from last time or first lecture, anything? Okay, so just stop me if you have questions. So what's the idea for doing that is to explore what we call this method of types. And I won't talk much about it, just very simple facts about it. So this is the idea that you have an n-bit string. For example, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0. And then I would say that the type of the string, is the number of ones. Number of ones that appear on the string, right? So the string has n components. If they all one, the type is n, if he has only one 1, the type is 1, and so on, right? So you just count the number of 1s. It's very simple. It's just like the Hamming distance of this string. And we know by simple probability theory, maybe some of you know this, if you don't have one proof, but it's true, that when n grows, if you look at these states, right, and this state was very simple, let me remind you, rho was just this guy. Okay, with probabilities 1 minus p will have 0, probabilities p will have 1. It's the simplest probability distribution possible. Then you can approximate this guy very well, and the approximation gets better and better when you increase the number of copies, n, by some sum over types. This type goes from 0 to n of a probability distribution, and some states, dt, such that this t doesn't run over all types, but t only runs over what we call typical types. And the definition of these are types such that t varies, maybe such that t belongs to the interval np minus some, maybe put, doesn't matter, like 2 square root of n and np plus 2 square root of n. Okay. Or 2, I don't know if it's a good number, but order. It's a constant times square root of n. Right, so why that makes sense? Well, this quantum state, n copies of the quantum state, you can think maybe you're drawing from this probability distribution n samples of it. Of course, they are independent and identically distributed, so you expect that there is concentration there, right? There is like a law of large numbers. So you expect that you see roughly n p ones, right? Because that's the probability of having one, that's the distribution. So you expect that on average you see n p ones. But you have some variation, but this variation, because it's independent distributions, it's square roots of the number of samples, right? So that's why you have this deviation of 1 square root of n. So to leading order, the type will be concentrated on np, and you can show that this happens with very high probability. So you have this good approximation of only typical types. Good, so now why that's useful? Well, because if you want to distill, we can just think how we're going to distill from the typical types, right? We don't have to think about atypical types. Of course, they are there, and if you apply the distillation, they will give some small error in the outputs. But we don't care; this error will be very small. So you focus only on typical types. And to do that, another important thing that, right, it's very clear: there's only n types, right? So there aren't so many types, right? And what we're going to do is just to analyze distillation first. When we have a particular typical type. So we're just going to pretend that the state is just pt now for a particular type, see how we would seal from it, and then you see that if you just apply the same protocol to all the typical types, it will work and we'll get the right amount of work that we want. So we're going to suppose. That at the moment at least, that gamma L, the Gibbs states, and rho n, the states, they consist of single type. Yes?
Why is square root of n
zero? Because when you have samples from independent samples from the same distribution, right, the variance will be square root of the number of samples you have. So that's the intuitive idea. Of course, we have to quantify how this error decreases with n, and actually decreases exponentially with n. Actually decreases exponentially with square root of n, but this I didn't show. But intuitively, it's just that you have many, many samples from the same distribution and independent samples. Right? Okay, so suppose that we have these two states, and they consist of a single type. So what is the state corresponding of single type, or is just a uniform? It's just a uniform mixture of all strings, right, of length n with the right number of ones there, right, given by the type. So it's a uniform mixture of strings of length N plus L, right? N from the resource state, L from the Gibbs state. And each is composed of two like substrings. The first right it corresponds to the Gibbs state, so it has LK ones, L times Q ones, right? So L is the number of copies of the Gibbs state, Q is the probability that you have a one in the Gibbs state. The second string corresponding to the resource state, it has NP ones. And now we have this uniform mixture over these two, this takes a uniform mixture over all strings of length L and LK ones, and a uniform mixture over all strings of length N and NP ones. So how many strings are there in total? Right, that's easy combinatorics, right? So we just, how many strings are in the first case? Well, it's L, choose LQ, right? Because the other were the ones, right, if you change, you know, suppose where there is a one doesn't matter, right? So it's just the binomial of L, choose LK, LQ. And the same thing for the resource, so it's N, choose NP. But these binomial numbers, right, they're annoying, to work with them, we like prefer entropies, right? But there's a very good approximation in some regimes of the binomial by the entropy, and we're going to use that. So whenever you have, like, for example, N and some lambda N, where N grows and lambda is fixed, this is always smaller than 2 to the binary entropy, 2 to the N, times the binary entropy of lambda, and it's always bigger than 2 to the n times the binary entropy of lambda divided by some polynomial. And this polynomial actually, because we are over like bit strings, it's just n plus 1, I think. So to leave in order, right, we have some exponential in n times the h lambda, where it's h lambda is the binary entropy. So it's just minus lambda log lambda minus 1 minus lambda log lambda. This we call the binary entropy. So it means that to linear order that we care about here, like, you know, the smaller terms they won't be relevant. You can approximate this by 2 to the L HQ plus N HP. It's just, right, this site information. Good, so we know how many strings we have initially, right? So if you restrict the Gibbs state and the resource state to this fixed type, that will be the entropy of this state that we have, right? This, sorry, not the entropy, the log of that will be the entropy, right? That's the number of states that we have there. Right, so what's the goal? The goal is to get this work bits in the end, right? It's to get the one states in the end. So we want to map all these strings, right, in the subspace, map the strings into other strings with at least M, right, the number of work bits that we get, M ones in rightmost position. So we have, right, this uniform mixture of all the strings of a given type. We want to find some unitary that maps all of them to some other uniform, some other mixture over strings of a given number of ones, but where we localize as many ones as possible on the right, right? Because then we throw away the rest and we keep these ones on the right, and they'll be in a pure state, right? In the useful pure state. Okay, so that's the end of the lecture, thank you. So I guess he wants me to break the file. All right. So let me draw what I did last time, right? So here's some picture. This is the Gibbs state, so we have L peaks here, and we have, right, it's a uniform mixture of all these strings. This is like a particular string in this mixture, and it contains roughly LQ ones, right? And there's sublinear terms in L here, like square root of L, but they won't matter, so I'm just going to ignore them here. Then we also have the resource state, is again mod bit string with n bits, and it has n p ones. And you want to map this to this thing. You want to map this to the final mixture of strings, which could be something like this, where we have k bits here, and then we have m bits, and they are all ones. Okay. And this is like, you know, this is this exhaust state, it's the trash we're going to throw away, and we assume that it contains RK ones. R we're going to determine, right? Where it has to be. Okay? So that's the procedure we want to do, and we want to do this by a unitary that conserves energy. So we have a lot of constraints, and they are the only constraints on which unitaries would do the job, right? So what are the constraints we have to satisfy? The first is that it's conservation of time of dimension, right? We want to go from here to here by a unitary. So because of that, the initial dimension of the Hilbert space has to be the same as the final one. So this says that k, right, the number of bits in the exhaust state, has to be equal to L plus n, the initial number of bits, minus n. Okay, so that's one constraint. We can call it conservation of dimension. The second one is where we use that U has to commute with the Hamiltonian, so it has to preserve energy, right? And energy in this simplest situation we're considering is just the number of excited states, right? It's just the number of ones that we have. So the number of ones have to be preserved. So this means that LQ, which is the number of ones here in the Gibbs state, plus NP, which is the number of ones in the original resource state, has to be equal to RK, which is the number of ones in the exhaust states, plus m. Okay. So this is conservation energy. And finally, we have to use a unitary, right, to do this mapping. So we cannot decrease the entropy, right? So the entropy of the source has to be preserved. So what it means is that the number of streams that we have in the end has to be, maybe it can increase, but it has to be, if you add some more noise, but it has to be equal to, has to be at least as big as the initial number of strings, right? So what's the final number of strings? Well, this is k, x, not e, 2, it's, I'm using like logs in base 2, so it's 2 to the power of k binary entropy of r, right, by the approximation we saw before. So we have this exhaust state where we have RK ones and bit strings of length K. This has to be bigger or equal than the initial number of strings, right? That we computed before, and it was exponential L binary entropy of Q plus N binary entropy of P. And this is conservation of entropy. Which means in this case that we have to use a unitary, right? So U is unitary. Okay, and because I'm taking U unitary, actually more precise, right, we must have this, right? So the entropy has to be conserved. Exactly. So we have these three relations. And now what we do is we just, you know, we use this first relation and the second one, and we replace the third one, okay? And if we do that, we'll find this equation. So entropy of Q plus epsilon, and if you remember, epsilon was n over L, and R was m over n, I think, you see it? I don't see it all. let's check, but I think that was right. Yes, m over n. Right, so this is two definitions. Then if we replace things, we find that binary entropy of Q plus epsilon binary entropy of P has to be, well, actually in this case is equal to 1 plus epsilon minus R epsilon binary entropy of Q plus epsilon P minus epsilon R divided by 1 plus epsilon minus epsilon R. So something a little bit complicated, right? But it's clear how to get it, right? So by this equation, we can just take the 2 here, right? So why not just, it might disappear, but, right? So we just have this equality between k times binary entropy of R equals L binary entropy of Q plus N binary entropy of P. Then we divide everything by L, right? N divided by L is this epsilon. And then we just use this equation here, right? These two equations, and replace, you know, you have to do a calculation. I don't want to do here, not to lose so much time, but it's an easy calculation where you just replace the first two equations with the second, the third, and we get it. So now, now we have this equation. So if this equation, you know, if we can find epsilon and R that satisfies this equation, that gives us a possible protocol, right? That gives a protocol which uses n over epsilon Gibbs states, copies of the Gibbs state, and gives a rate m over n. So now we want to see what's the best we can do here, right? What's the best choice of parameters to satisfy this equation? That's not so clear how to do that, but what we can do is to simplify things, and that's in the end the right thing to do, is to take epsilon and consider what happens when epsilon goes to 0. Okay? So epsilon goes to 0 means that L is much bigger than n, right? So we're taking many more Gibbs states than resource states, but we don't care, right? Gibbs states we can use as many as we want. So we send epsilon to 0, and what we do now, we expand this side to first order in epsilon. Again, we do the calculation if we have time. That's an easy calculation, you just write this. Entropy is a simple function of epsilon, so you can do expand to first order. And then we expand to first order and take the limits when epsilon goes to 0. Okay? And we see what we get. And what do you get if you do that, and you have to trust me because I don't want to do the calculation, is that the rate that we get is equal to binary entropy of Q minus binary entropy of P plus P minus Q over temperature divided by binary entropy of Q plus 1 minus Q over C. And again, if you do the math, you see that that's equal to the ratio of relative entropies. So what we have on the top is just the relative entropy of rho to the Gibbs state, tau H. And what we have on the board is the same, but now the relative entropy, right, the final state, 2 tau. Okay, which is what we want to get, right? So the rate of going from rho to 1 is given by the ratio of the relative entropies, right? So that's what we want to get, so that's good. So this is for... Okay, so this is for, right, for one type. You can do the same thing for all types. All we have to realize is that typical types, they have roughly the same number of ones, right? But they have this variance, which is of order square root of n. So now what we will do is just, you get the worst type, the worst of the typical types, namely the type that has the minimum number of ones. You design the protocol for it, and the same protocol will work on the other ones equally well, right? And so in the end, you just, everything that I did here, we do for the worst type and apply the same one to all the typical types, and if you work, you get the result that you want. I will skip the details. Also, I don't have so much time. The work cost is a very similar argument. I won't tell you in details. So basically what you do here, you just do the reverse process now, right? You start from here, And so you start from some copies of work bits. Now here you have some, instead of this trash state, you have some Gibbs state. And then again, you set up a unitary such that what you have in the end is, now here is any state you want, doesn't matter, but the right state here, the right type of the resource state. And then you do the same kind of constraints, you do the same calculation, and you see that it works as well. Okay, so really it's just running the process in reverse, but changing the exhaust state by the Gibbs states, and changing the Gibbs state by the exhaust states. You just change the role of this one. And if you do that, you see that you get exactly the same rate, but inverse, right? So you get this as a numerator, and this one as a denominator. Good. So another comment, so I think I will only give in detail this simple case, all the rest will just comment how it works. What happens, right? This, we explore, we show how it works when rho is diagonal in energy eigenbasis. How about the general case, right? What happens in the general case? And what we do in the general case is that we map the general case to this case where, you know, where rho is diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. And we can do that because, you know, we have this many copies of the Hamiltonian and we can think right about, you have like this non-interacting regime. So what you can do is you can map rho to the N. So you can decohere it in the energy eigenbasis, right? So these are the projectors onto given energies, onto a given energy. Maybe let's say it looks like this. And the number of E's is very small, right? The number of E's is just all possible energies. If you have N subsystem, it goes from 0 to N, right? So you have, in the simplest case of 1 qubit, you have just N possible energies. So what it means is that you can decohere in the energy eigenbasis when n is very big without losing very much, right? So you can decohere in the energy eigenbasis just introducing log n bits of entropy, right? Because this is how many different elements you have in the sum, so you're just introducing log n bits of entropy. So what it means is that actually you can just first decohere the states, then you apply the protocol that we just saw before when the states are diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. Then this will give the rates that you get, right, to something like a relative entropy of E P rho n E with respect to the Gibbs state, but now the Gibbs state is some number of copies, but because you introduce so little entropy, this is roughly just n copies of the relative entropy plus log n. So this doesn't matter, right? This is insignificant. So the important lesson here is that because you have many copies, coherence do not matter actually. Okay, so you can just destroy them and you don't lose too much, right? And why that's the case? Well, because you don't have so many types, right? So you have just like n different energy levels when you have n copies, but you have this huge degeneracy subspace where you can operate, right? And what you do is operate in this energy, in this degenerate energy subspaces. For a single copy, things would be different, right? But here it doesn't matter. Yes?
I got confused about the n. Like, n now is the number of energy states or the number of copies? I mean,
n is the number of copies. But it's also the number of energy states, right? Because the Hamiltonian, it has like a ground state is zero and one is excited. So now if you have n independent copies, right? Yes, exactly, everything, yes. And if it wasn't qubits, we would be like order log n, right? But there would be some other factor there. Good, so that's what I want to say. And for work, for the work cost of the distribution, again, you can just map to the case of diagonal ones, but that is more interesting, right? Because you cannot create coherences if you don't have coherences in the first place. So for the work costs, you need an extra resource. Okay, so work costs you cannot do just by Fermat operations in the non-diagonal case. non-diagonal, you need an extra resource, which is basically some state in a uniform superposition of energies. So you need need extra superposition over energy eigenstates, over energy states. But that's not so important because, again, because coherences are, you know, they don't scale exponentially in the number of copies. We only need a sublinear amount of coherence. So the dimension of this state that we need, or the number of qubits of this state superposition, there again, order log n. So we just treat this as some sublinear resource that we have to invest, but it's very small, we don't count it. Okay? If you know entanglement theory, this is very similar to entanglement formation, right, of pure states. So to distill entanglement from pure states, we need no classical communication, we just need local operations. We locally project and we get the maximum entangled state. If you want to form a state, pure states, from BPR pairs, we need some amount of communication, but it's square root n amount of communication, so it's sublinear. And the reasons are very similar here, right? So there you want to do some entanglement spreading, you have to invest some amount of communication to create some entanglement spreading, because BPR pairs have no entanglement spreading, and in general, pure entangled states have. And here is the same, right? But now here you have to create some energy spreading, right? So noisy operations map states diagonal in the energy eigenbasis, states diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. Warp bit is diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. So how you create coherence? You have to get coherence from somewhere else. But luckily, if you have many copies, it's just very little, right? So you don't need a lot of coherence. But as I'm going to mention now, this is a problem in this
scenario. Yes. Change the class of operations?
Yeah, no, it's something extra. So, strictly speaking, if you just want to do from operations and that's it, you cannot create any state which is non-diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. But if you allow a little bit more of resource which doesn't scale with n, scale sublinear with n, then you can do it. Okay. So, that's all I want to say about many copies. Now I want to, before going to the slides, I want to just mention what would be the results, the analogous results here for catalytic single copy transformations. Again. Rebellious. So what's the idea? Is the idea now is that we have the system as before, but now we will not assume that we have many copies of the states. We have one copy of the states. Okay, so now we want to see, for example, how like the second law of thermodynamics, which for isothermal processes is just given in terms of the free energy, how this would change. You have now a single copy of the state. You don't have any thermodynamic limits, right? So in this version I gave you, we were taking this very simple thermodynamic limit because it was non-interacting, so it's just taking many copies of the state, the same state. But now what happens if you have just one copy of the state? But then we have the BEF, as usual, or the reservoir. I was calling this R. But now we add something extra as well, which is very used in thermodynamics, which is some catalysts, right? And why we always use catalysts in thermodynamics? Well, this is the working body. It's like our engine, right, that we use to extract work, and in the end we have this engine there as it was initially, and we can use it again. So I have these three subsystems, right? And again, we can define the same kind of operations we defined before, from operations, but now catalytic, rho into sigma. What we mean by that is that there exists some pi, some state pi, which has some Hamiltonian, and we can choose the Hamiltonian of the working body, but such that we can do this transformation by Fram operations. Okay. And then, you know, before for noisy operations, this was given in terms of this Rennie entropies, right? We could equally write this in terms of the relative entropy of Rennie entropies to the maximally weak states, right? What we saw is just some additive factor by log t. As you can expect, now we have the same thing, but replacing maximally weak states by Gibbs states, right? By Fermat states. And that's indeed what you can prove. This is by a lot of people, so I won't write, so it's more by myself with Michal Horodesky, Jonathan Oppenheim, Nelly Nitsch, and Stephanie Wiener from 2013. And what you can show is that, and now coherence, there are big problems we don't know how to handle, so the result is that if rho and sigma are diagonal, okay, we are almost done with the slides, so with the tablet, so that's good. If rho and sigma are diagonal, energy eigenbasis, rho can go by Fermat operations catalytic into sigma if and only if all the Rennie relative entropies to respect to the Gibbs states, they are monotonic. For all of the bigger equals to zero. Okay, so that's for right when states are diagonal in the energy eigenbasis. If they are not diagonal in the energy eigenbasis, in the general case, we only have one direction, which is the east direction, right? We have, in general, we only know that it's only if. Okay, so all this S alpha, they are monotones, so they must decrease, right? So it's a only if only. Okay, so it gives limitations, right? See, so if you have a process, if you can go from rho to sigma, it must be the case that all S alphas of rho are bigger than S alphas of sigma. But the reverse, we don't know. We don't know if it's true or not. And actually, we know it's not true. Okay, so in general, we know it's only if, but we know we have more constraints. Okay, so we have other definitions of S alpha, which are quantum. In the quantum case, there are many ways to define this S alpha, right? Because now rho and tau, they don't commute, so it's not doesn't reduce to probability distributions, and we have more constraints. And it's an open question, what are the other all constraints, right? Open question. Well, what are all the constraints? And we don't know. Okay, so simple question, we don't know. So you, one way that we sometimes talk about these results is that this gives like second loss now, right? Instead of free energy is like right manifestation of the second law. But now if you go to these very small subsystems where we just have one copy of the states, like one atom or one electron, then we still have the constraint that the free energy has to decrease, but we have more constraints. Okay, so we have less constraints given by these Rennie generalizations of the free energy. And if you impose coherences even more, like you go really to the quantum case, coherence in energy eigenstates, then we have even more constraints. We have some more that I won't write what they are, but there are some other versions of Rennie relative entropies, which are not given by these ones. But we don't know what are all the constraints. Okay, so I think that's an interesting question, but I leave it to you. So, okay. Right. So there's more I could talk about Fermat dynamics. I didn't talk about what happens for approximate catalysts, for example. And then again, there are a lot of open questions that we don't understand. So with approximate catalysis, if you define it in one particular way that in principle appears good, we see that we get some nonsense answers, like, you know, we can convert any state into any other. There is no notion of resource. And that's because some phenomenon in entanglement theory that is called embezzlement of entanglement. You can do the same thing with energy, you can do embezzlement of energy. So we find that we have to be very careful how to define, you know, like how to put some errors in the catalyst, right? Instead of returning the catalyst exactly, we can return with some error. That's very natural, but it's very unclear what's the right way to quantify this error. Okay, so I won't talk about that, but that's also another interesting open question. Maybe just write another open question if you're interested in work on this, would be to understand approximate catalysis. And in this paper, what this is proven, it's discussed there, so you can check there, or you can ask me later. And maybe some other open question, right? And there's no recent works around it, but just mentioned, is how, right, so is to add adiabatic processes to the formalism, right? One way to do that is that, you know, for example, at some point, you know, you're in some isothermal process, which is what is from operators are describing, but then you stop it, and then your adiabatics change the Hamiltonian of the system from one to another, right? This would be like this, corresponds to adiabatic processes. Some people are looking into that, and then, for example, you can start studying things like Carnot cycle and so on, and then you see that for Carnot cycle, in the single copy level, the efficiency of the Carnot cycle is worse than of the asymptotic set, right, as we expect. So there is some results in this direction, but I think there is more to be done. And okay, so now I want to finish about thermodynamics and go to statistical mechanics, where it will be just a bit of overview. But before that, is there any question about what I said? Yes.
What happens for the single shot case?
Right, single shot case. I didn't mention that. Yes. So if you don't have a catalyst, again you have some kind of majorization, but it's called thermal majorization. So it's basically, it's similar to majorization, but now you have to get your distribution and multiply it by some Boltzmann weights in an appropriate way, and then see if this modified distribution majorizes the other. So I will take some time to describe, but also, yeah, you get some very similar majorization, but it's different. Any other question? Okay. So let me change here. Okay, that's now it finally is. Does this connect to the computer? Pretty good. Okay, good. So now, right. So like in the last half hour, I just want to tell you a little bit about some other connections that there is of quantum information, but now with statistical mechanics. And here will be, the approach will be quite different from what we have been discussing so far. It will be more on the technical side than on the conceptual side, as in, well, in the sense that we, in many cases, we're just going to get very traditional problems in statistical mechanics that and use the formulation that people have done before, but we will have new tools to analyze this problem, so we'll be able to say different things about the problem, but it will be like, you know, old, well-established problems, right? Whereas before we were trying to, you know, maybe generalize thermodynamics or find a new language for it, now we're just going to try to answer some like old problems in statistical mechanics, but from a different perspective using tools from quantum information. So there will be like some very basic problems that we need to consider. You all saw them before, but still they, I think they're very interesting conceptually. So they all will involve, like, you know, suppose you have a Hamiltonian with n particles. So it's a sum of local terms, right? You can imagine speed chain or higher dimensions. This will be the energy eigenbasis, and this will be the eigenvalues, so the energies. And it will be interesting in understanding like two fundamental states in statistical mechanics, which are the microcanonical states and the canonical states. Okay? So what's the microcanonical states? Well, it's just we have the is a state that we use to compute average of some observable x in the microcanonical ensemble at some mean energy E. So this is given by trace tau EX. Tau E is this microcanonical state. And this is nothing but the uniform mixture over energy eigenstates in some energy window, right? So we have the set M E delta. This is the set of all energies that are within some energy window around mean energy E. Right, so we have n particles, the total energy is the mean energy times n, and we look at all eigenvalues which are, you know, which are close to En, at most by some factor delta square root of n. Right, the square root of n again is what we usually see, right, in the deviation of energy. And then we just look at the uniform mixture, the maximum mixed state in the subspace. Okay, so that's the microcanonical state. And later we'll go back to the Gibbs state, right, that we saw before, but first let's consider this microcanonical state. And one of the first results that we got, that people got for like where quantum information was useful to understand like some basic properties in statistical mechanics, was try to understand why this microcanonical state is a good description of the state of the system, right? So when we expect to use a microcanonical state, we expect to use it whenever we have a system in isolation and we know nothing about the system except the energy, right? So the typical interpretation is some subjective interpretation says that the microcanonical state represents our subjective description of the system given knowledge only of the energy, right? So we know that the system is in isolation, we know the energy, but we know nothing more. So you know, we just assume that all states of the right energy are equally probable, right? And that's one way to introduce these states. One of the early results, first ones on like quantum information field dynamics, was a way of relaxing this assumption, okay, saying that we didn't have to consider the subjective interpretation, but there was also an equally a plausible objective interpretation of the microcanonical states. And this is the following. So it's by many people found that at the same time. So suppose you have a Hamiltonian, and I suppose that this SE is the subspace of all states with energy between these two numbers. Okay, so it's just the space spanned by eigenstates of energy between En minus delta square root of n and En plus delta square root of n. Then what you can show is that for almost every state in the subspace, but pure states now, right? So you take not all, but most states in the subspace, and for any region that you choose, okay, so you're not going to measure in the whole system, but you're going to measure observables in a small part of the system, region A, then the states, this, the reduced states, right, you trace out everything except in the region A, this is the complement of A, the psi, and the reduced state of the microcanonical states, they will be very close. They like locally they look the same. So what it's saying is, you know, in physics usually you just do these local observations, so it's saying that it's the same if you think about just the maximum mixed state in the subspace, or if you think about just having some arbitrary state in the subspace, but generic in a sense. So this is the second interpretation, that this microcanonical ensemble, it represents now the objective state of the system. It's in a particular pure quantum state. We don't know where it is, but it's there. It has the right energy. And the randomness now comes from entanglement between A and A components. Right? This is really that we have a very strong... So in quantum states of large dimension, they have a lot of regularity. Okay? This is some phenomenon that is used a lot in quantum information, which is called this concentration of measure. Okay, and I just want to state what it is, and not really explain, prove how it relates to this, but you see the point. So what I mean by almost every state, I just mean that if you take with high probability over the Haar measure in the subspace, right? So we have the subspace SE, is some vector space. We can define a unitary invariance measure in this subspace. This we call Haar measure. And that's just a way of picking states at random, like uniformly at random from the subspace. The result is that with overwhelming probability over this measure, all these states psi, locally they will look like microcanonical. Okay? So this is a consequence of a very useful result that we use all the time in quantum information theory, right? Yes?
What do you mean in the objective states?
Objective meaning that it's in a pure state, right?
Ah, okay.
So like the maximum state of knowledge in quantum theory, right?
Cool.
It's not that, whereas here, you know, we have some objective probabilities over the state, right? Say, okay, it's in one state, we don't know what it is, so we, because we don't know, we assume that it's uniform, a mixture over all energy eigenstates. Here is different. Here we say, okay, it's in a particular state, but still we see microcanonical because of the entanglement of the the subsystem with the rest of the system. So what is this result? This is a very nice result about high-dimensional geometry. And of course, pure quantum states are just points in some hypersphere, right? So that's why you can use it. And it just says that if you have a Lipschitz function, okay, so it's just a function f, which is continuous, Lipschitz continuous, from the n-dimensional sphere to the real numbers, then you can compute the average of this function over the whole hypersphere, right? And then you can prove that with overwhelming probability, like exponentially small in the dimension, in n, the function will concentrate around the average. Okay, so the function is almost completely regular. It's almost constant everywhere, right? So it really concentrates around the average for almost every x in Sn, okay? And this is exactly the kind of result that we want here, right? So this, you know, the trace norm difference of these two quantities is nothing but some function of psi, right? So it's a function of quantum states, which you can think as function in of points in this higher dimensional sphere, right? In this hypersphere. You can do some calculation, you see that this is Lipschitz continuous, that's easy. So you can just directly apply this Lebesgue lemma here, right? And if you apply it, we get the result that I stated here. Okay, so that's very simple, but I think it was a first nice application of this kind of results. And this Lebesgue lemma is applied many other ways in quantum information, right? It's applied to understand generic properties of entanglement. It's applied to get good protocols for information communication and so on. So it's something good to have in mind, to know that it exists at least right now. I'm sure you can find other applications soon. Good. Now a second problem, there is also I want to talk a little bit about it, which is something that I have been thinking about more recently, is to try to understand more about a second important state in statistical mechanics, which is the canonical state, right? So again, what defines the canonical ensemble? Now we have some temperature, and I'm using inverse temperature here, beta, and the canonical ensemble averages you compute just doing trace x and the Gibbs state that we saw before, right? Rho beta. And this rho beta is just e to the minus beta h over partition function, right? So it's the state that we saw previously. And now, okay, we have these two states, right, that we can use in statistical mechanics. And we understand when we should use each of them, right? When we should use each ensemble. So when we first learn this problem, we see that micro we should use when the system is in isolation, right? When the system is not interacting with anything else, and the energy is fixed. Or if the number of particles is fixed, you have a different microanonical state. The macro, we think about it in the situation that we were analyzing before in thermodynamics, which is when the system is interacting with a very big path, a very big reservoir, and it's in thermal equilibrium with it, right? So system in equilibrium with a heat path at inverse temperature, at temperature 1 over beta, then we expect that in equilibrium, the system in S will be canonical, will be the Gibbs state. So that's what I just said, macro follows from micro, usually by considering the system and the path in the microcanonical ensemble. So the system and the environment, they are in some, right? They are isolated system and they are in the microcanonical state. But now we look at the reduced state of the system and there we see a canonical state, right? So it's a way to derive canonical from microcanonical. And there are some derivations, right? Textbooks, you can read this. It's hard to make it completely rigorous, but it's quite convincing. But what's important here, for this to be true, otherwise it's not true in general, is that the system only interacts with the environment very weakly, right? That the Hamiltonian of the system is much stronger than the interactions between the system and the environment. So the question that I want to address is if we can extend this relation between microcanonic and canonical. So the question here is whether, suppose we are only interested in the expectation values of local observables. Okay, so we have a system. This is our Hamiltonian, for example, right? It's like nearest neighbor interaction in two dimensions. And we can define the canonical state here, the microcanonical state here, but there's no path. But suppose we are only interested in the expectation values of single spins, for example, of a few spins, like magnetization, or two-point correlation functions, and so on. Then, can it be the case that it actually doesn't matter which ensemble we use, that we can use either the microcanonical or the canonical ensemble, and the answer will be the same? So like, the question is whether, when the system can be an environment for itself, right? And why this is not just the same question as the one we saw before? Well, because here we have a Hamiltonian everywhere, we don't assume weak coupling or anything, right? So here we just have a Hamiltonian, and we want to see if locally the two ensembles are the same. So it can be strong interactions everywhere, for example. But of course, we know this weak coupling is necessary in general, but so it's a different question here now. Here we compare the global Gibbs state with the global microcanonical state, and we are interested in seeing whether they are the same or not. So this will be the equation, right? So we have an expectation value of a local observable with respect to the microcanonical ensemble at some mean energy corresponding to inverse temperature theta. We want to see whether this expectation value will be similar to the one of the canonical state at the temperature inverse temperature theta. And of course, we have to match, right, the energy, the mean energy of the two. So we just choose the mean energy as a function of temperature, such that the microcanonical and the canonical state has the same mean energy. So the question, matching the mean energy, do these states locally look the same? And actually, this is a very old question. This is called like equivalence of ensemble question. And this goes back really like to this pioneer works by Gibbs, for example. He was already discussing or already suggesting that sometimes these two states should be locally the same. Or, I mean, he didn't have this concept of locally the same, but that they should be the same in some cases. So what he said, if you take like the average square of the anomalies of energy, what he means by that is just you take the variance of the energy. You find an expression which vanishes, standard deviation of the energy. We find an expression which vanishes in comparison to the square of the average energy. Okay, so he just said that all the sentences in modern language, he's saying that the variance of the energy is very small. Okay, when the number of degrees of freedom increases. So because Hamiltonian would take n bigger and bigger, indeed the energy will be tightly concentrated both in the canonic and the microcanonic ensemble. Okay, there's some concentration of energy. And they say, ensemble of systems in which the number of degrees of freedom is of the same order of magnitude as the number of molecules in the body with which we experiment, if distributed canonically, if it's in the Gibbs state, would therefore appear to human observation as an ensemble of systems in which all have the same energy. In other words, the microcanonical state. So he's saying here that because the energy in the Gibbs state is very concentrated around the mean value when n grows, it's okay if you just cut the rest and just keep this uniform superposition there, this uniform mixture over like around this mean energy, which is the microcanonical state. So in modern language, right, we have the specific heat. This is given by the variance of the energy. When the system is not critical, this variance grows linearly in the volume. So the fluctuations of the energy, they are square root n, right? Much smaller than, for example, the total energy of the system. So this gives some intuition, but it doesn't really work in general. And because it's easy to check that on the level of quantum states, if you look at the microcanonical states and the canonical states, they are almost orthogonal to each other, right? When n grows, they become more and more orthogonal. The trace norm goes to the maximum value. Okay, so globally they are not the same, right? Even though energy is concentrated, they are really not the same. They are very far from each other. So Gibbs had the right idea, but we need to add something more, right? We have to add locales to the problem. We have to add that we only care about local expectation values. And this is a problem that people study statistical mechanics. They like it. They call it the equivalence of ensembles. So before, as a traditionally statistical mechanics, they like to work with the thermodynamic limits, right, where they take the limits of an infinite number of particles from the beginning and have their own language to describe these limits. So, for example, you can prove that you have a unique phase, this means a unique AMS state, you have this equivalence of ensembles, okay? So I won't tell what this is, more like this language of mathematical physics. But what matters for us here is that, forget about this thermodynamic limits, what matters for the problem to have this equivalence of ensemble is that you have a finite correlation length in the system, okay? So we know that, for example, even for the 2D Ising model, this is like magnetization, this is temperature. If when we approach a phase transition, a thermal to phase transition, the two ensembles, the expectation value of the two ensembles, which are which were the same before, they start to diverge, okay? They start to become different. So we know that we can only hope to prove something about this equivalence if we are far away from a phase transition, meaning if we have a finite correlation length. So the right physical thing appears to be the correlation length, and that's indeed related to having this unique phase, but this is a more technical term. So what I want to tell you now, that I think, yes.
Just to go back to you.
Yes.
You mentioned that this is the equivalence is only valid low. What do you mean exactly?
At this, let me go back. This, that's whenever x, whenever x is observable, that only acts on a few spins, the expectation value in the two states will be the same. But if you have some x acting globally, it might be different. And we know it is, because we know the two states, they are very different on the level of, right, of states that in the full Hilbert space. Right, so that seems like an interesting problem, and what I want to tell you now, a little bit, is just how you can use some techniques from quantum information, like, you know, some new entropies that we develop in quantum information and some new properties of relative entropy, for example, to find a result about this equivalence of ensembles that that I think goes beyond this original results, because uses the correlation length and it is like a finite size bound, right? So let me tell you what's the result. So it's the equivalence for finite systems. What it says is that if you have a Hamiltonian on n particles, on a d-dimensional lattice, and have some inverse temperature, such that the Gibbs state has correlation length psi. I'll define what correlation length is, but intuitively you know, right, correlations decay fast with distance. And then we fix some delta, forget about this, but just, you can think delta is constant, okay? So the variance in the microcanonical state is of square root n, but it can vary as well. Then, if you look at most regions A, right, so here, for example, is the lattice. Here is some region A, which is small. So we look at regions which are smaller than the total size. The total number of spins is n, and the regions, they can be at most like n to the power of 1 over z plus 1. This is the dimension of the lattice. So they are substantially smaller than the whole lattice. This is the upper bound you can get. And then the result is that the two states are the same. Okay, so if you look at the microcanonical states of with mean energy E of beta, if you trace out everything except in the region A, right? So this is just the global state in the region A. This is the same as the canonical states. Okay, so this is like this local equivalence of ensembles, right, that I mentioned before. And of course it depends on the correlation length, and we know it has to depend on the correlation length, right? So this is the right kind of statement. So what's the correlation length? It's very simple, it's just, suppose you have two observables, X and Z, in some Gibbs states. And then we say that the state has correlation length psi if the correlations decay exponentially with the distance between x and z. So x measured as here, z some other region here. And then if there is correlation length psi, correlations decay as this equation. And correlations are just right, so expectation value of the product of the observables and the product of the expectation values. So I think it's a kind of interesting result because it gives finite size bounds that the other ones could not give, right? It works in general, like for before you need translation invariance, always for taking this limit here, we don't need it. And it's based on, I think, the right physical quantity, which is the correlation length, right? This is what matters to have this equivalence. You can have a smaller energy spread, fine. Good. So, So now, what I want to do is, it's a bit technical, but what I want to show you is just how to get this result, you basically replace some old arguments that, or some older arguments that people had by arguments from quantum information, and because they're stronger arguments, we can get this better balance. So I want to compare like two methods. One is this work by Muller and collaborators, where they use like this, you know, this maybe this older language of statistical mechanics to prove a result of similar failure. And the way they did is that they consider a sequence of Hamiltonians on finite volumes when the volume goes to infinity. Then we can define the free energy density. The free energy density is just, you minimize the mean free energy, this is the mean energy, this is the mean entropy. We minimize over all translation invariant states in this infinite volume. And then what we can show, this is some result by Simons, is that actually the free energy of the Gibbs state, sorry, the free energy of the microcanonical state is the same as the free energy of the canonical state. Okay? So these two guys, when in the limits, they have the same free energy. And because of that, we can assume this one-phase region, which just says that there is a unique minimizer for this function. Okay, there is a unique translation invariant state that minimizes the function, which is the Gibbs state. If you assume it's unique, and this is unique phase assumption, then because these two states they have the same free energy, they have to become locally the same. Okay? They have to converge to the same limiting states. Okay, so, and that's this assumption. And so that's how you usually prove this equivalence of ensemble asymptotically. So now what you want to do is to replace both these results by finite versions of it and by results that look more like, you know, quantum information language. So just take what the results are, we'll not prove them. So one is an analog of this kind of result. It says that you have two quantum states on n qubits in d dimensions. And suppose that rho has finite correlation length psi, this will be like the Gibbs state right later. Then, if the relative entropy of the two states is small, it's like, you know, instead, the relative entropy could be linear in this case in n, but we assume it's much smaller, it's log 2dn. Okay? Then, locally, the states are the same. So, for most regions C, of up to this size, the two states will look the same. Right? So, we are replacing some unique phase assumption by just having finite correlation and get some finite results, right? And here we use some tools that were developed in quantum information that I won't tell what it is. So this is basically saying, right, so if, you know, if this is of course the difference of free energies that we saw before. If the free energy of any state is close enough to the Gibbs state, locally the state has to be Gibbs. Okay? This is like some minimization of free energy, the uniqueness of the free energy on the Gibbs state, but some finite, some approximate version. And the second is that actually, if rho t has a finite correlation length, and rho t is the Gibbs state, the relative entropy of the microcanonical state and of the Gibbs state is small enough. Okay, so combine the two, you get the result. So I will not give you the results. What I want to do now is just to mention a little bit what, I won't tell you about the proof, but I won't tell you what's new in quantum information, and it's also new in some other problems that I didn't mention, that turns out to be useful in this problem, which is that we get all these old quantities like entropy and relative entropy, and we have generalized them. We have created a lot of other entropies, which is not a priori good why. You know, it's not clear why this is a good idea, right? We're just creating more entropy. But it turns out that they're very convenient when we are proving things, okay? And we were, and they have different properties, and they are new tools, really. They are useful for doing things, in particular for this result that I showed you. So these are some of the examples of them. So, for example, we can define the relative entropy. We can define what we call a smooth relative entropy, where we allow some approximation in these states. More importantly, we can define what we call like the single-shot counterparts, which they are like entropies that are supposed to describe the situation when you have only one copy of this state. So for example, we have this max relative entropy, which is given by this operator inequality, the minimum lambda, such that tau is smaller than 2 to the lambda rho. If you take limits when many copies of tau and rho in smooth, we recover the original one, but they are different notions. And we can like smooth this one as well, we consider approximations of the states and we minimize. Then we know relations between these entropies, and we know many properties of these entropies. Okay, and I'm running out of time, but the proof will be basically, I won't tell you, just to show you how, if you can read if you're interested, it's just how using these new entropies that we defined and their properties, you can manipulate them in the right way and prove this kind of results, right? So this is way quantum information is giving back. There are more problems that I won't talk. There is like equilibration, there is time of equilibration as well. Now you're interested about time scales of quantum systems equilibrating, and again there are results in this direction. Let me pass. Maybe I just finish with some other connections of quantum, other parts of quantum information with statistical mechanics and that I didn't mention, but some like, maybe these are all open questions. Okay, they are, I think, very nice open questions that maybe you want to think about them. One is about this, it's called quantum PCP conjecture. This comes from quantum complexity theory, but it's really a problem in statistical mechanics as well, in a sense. And this is the problem of the computational complexity of estimating the mean free energy of a quantum model. Okay, so to estimate the mean free energy of a classical model, so Ernest talked about a lot of complexity classes. So to estimate the mean free energy of a classical model is an NP-hard model. We would like to know if estimate the same for quantum models is quantum NP-hard. Okay, so that's a very interesting problem about free energy that we don't know. We'd like to know. A simpler problem that we also don't know is whether we can have like local models for which all eigenstates has a lot of entanglements, okay, like that they are very complex, but not just the ground state, but all eigenstates up to some finite mean energy. That this is again some problem about statistical mechanics at finite temperature that we don't understand. And finally, there's a very beautiful problem, self-correcting quantum memories, which relates statistical mechanics to error correction and to fault tolerance. And this is where we can find Hamiltonians, which are robust both under static perturbations and thermal perturbations, and take a long time to thermalize. In 4Z, we know we can do that. In 2Z, we have a lot of evidence that we cannot, but 3D is pretty open. And again, I think that's a very good question. So to conclusions, quantum information has benefited a lot from on statistical mechanics and thermodynamics. Now I hope I gave you some idea that you know, there are all these new works that use quantum information to say something, to try to contribute to these areas. And I think that we're just at the beginning, there is a lot of scope for more connections, and I hope you are motivated for any work in the area. And if you have any question or just want to say hi, you just send me an email. That's the email. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Fernando. Are there any questions?
Yes.
Has there been any attempt to make a theory of renormalization in this?
It's a tough question. So there is a couple of papers by, there are two instances. One is that if you look at real space normalization, more in the context of condensed matter, like in contents of a TMR3, for example, density matrix normalization group, then quantum understanding entanglements and this quantum information are very useful, and people are working a lot on like tensor networks and MERA, this multi-scale entanglement renormalization. So there's a lot of nice research in this area. If you just want to, renormalization is also a problem that you like to understand better conceptually, right? What's going on? In what sense we are losing information in some renormalization flow? In this respect, I think that's a problem where quantum probably can say a lot, quantum information can say a lot, but it hasn't been done so much. So I think it's a nice open question.
Any other questions? Okay, we thank Fernando again.
Thank you.